Greetings, War Thunderers. This is Longshot with you again. This video looks at the Spitfire Mark 1A and continues my arcade fighter tutorial series. This really is an iconic plane, the hero of the Battle of Britain, but it seems not everyone finds it easy to fly effectively. I'll start with looking at the plane's characteristics, and then show you a range of tactics, some that work and some that don't. The plane's armed with 8303 caliber machine guns mounted on the wings. These are most effective at close range, and I've set my convergence to 300 metres. Beyond about 400 metres, the bullets do very little damage at all, so firing beyond this range is a waste of time and ammo. So I'll just test its roll speed, which is reasonable but not that fast. The real strength of this plane is its quick response to both rudder and elevator, as shown in this snap roll. Next I'll tilt the plane on its side and look at its elevator turn speed, which is quite good. However, there are fighters that turn better. Biplanes, of course, but also Ishaks, Zeros, Hurricanes and P-36 Hawks. So we lost 100 kilometres an hour in that single turn, and while it now rolls faster, that energy loss can be a serious problem. Hitting rudder and elevator keys together makes the plane brake very sharply, which is an excellent way of getting someone off your tail and maybe forcing an overshoot. Now I'm going to deploy the landing flaps to see if they improve the Spitfire's turning speed as they do with many other fighters. And to be honest, I don't see any improvement. The main change is a further loss of speed, which could be something you use to again help force an overshoot. But under normal circumstances, speed is vital in this plane, as the slower it flies, the worse its handling becomes. Only perform loops in combat if your speed is high, otherwise you risk stalling your plane at the top of the loop. Now, I'd done quite well in this plane a year ago and I'd flown it a lot, but my memory's quite short, so I had to relearn the hard way how to fly the Mark 1 effectively. And the first thing I did was take it to high altitude, as it's a very good climber. And in one of my first battles, I met this Heinkel 112A0. Now, he's climbing hard in order to then dive at me, which will give him a short-term speed advantage. I'll quickly duck away from his cannon, but I take my eyes off him, thinking he'd gone past me, which he hadn't. He's still on my tail there. So I continue the turn, which has bled away all my speed, which forces him to overshoot, but also it's killed my maneuverability. Look at my speed there. By contrast, he's retained his speed and is now going to use it to make repeated fast attacking passes, which I'm left just trying to dodge and evade. Notice how easily I approach stall speed, and how terrible the plane's handling has become here at altitude. I try to deploy flaps while hitting WEP to try and increase lift in the wings, but to be honest, I'm in serious trouble here. And while this Spitfire is quite a good climber, once you're up here, the thin air exaggerates the poor energy retention of the plane and kills your ability to do what the plane does best, which is to dogfight. But here my opponent makes a mistake. Starts zoom climbing a bit too close to me, and I take a massive gamble, stalling my plane out, trying to hit him in his zoom climb. And I was very lucky to enter a stall spin right there as he was lining up the kill shot. So with a black wing, the Spitfire no longer responds to elevator key commands, which just roll the plane instead of making it turn and climb. So I'm restricted now to mouse aim only. And here my worthy adversary makes another mistake. He stops climbing and fighting me vertically. And he turns too close once again, and that lets me recover speed and get some guns on him. He had me on the ropes and he's let me off. Here's a pure rudder turn. Turns beautifully with rudder. And see, he's now trying to turn fight me on the horizontal, which suits the Spitfire well, but not the Heinkel. He makes one last attempt to resume energy fighting, but again he's too close to me now when he turns back, and he's going to take even more damage. After which he loses his taste for the fight, and then dives away. So after this very lucky escape, I decided to limit my altitude to 3,000 metres. I'm going to see how the plane performs using energy tactics. Now, there's a lag climbing at me, and he was too slow to match my climb. I'm just enticing him to use up the last of his speed and stall his plane, and to make sure that when I attack I'm avoiding a head-on. So he's just about stalled out there. So now I'm going to make a diving attack. At close range, my machine guns set him alight, but weren't able to strike a decisive blow. And I keep coming back at him for several passes, and eventually he dives away and I get an assist. But usually there's not a lot to do at this altitude. Bombers are higher and too tough for the Spitfire, and most fighters will be lower. And most of the time I use this altitude to position the plane and then dive into battle. A common belief is that many other planes are better turners, which is true, and that therefore the Spit Mark I is rubbish, and with that I beg to differ. When your energy is high, the Mark I can outfly other turn fighters, and diving gives you that energy. It all depends how you use that energy, and for me it took a little while to learn. In this case there's a Ki-43, which is no longer a great turn fighter, and an A-5M which most certainly is. So I'm just diving to attack, and when I arrived the Ki-43 came out in front of me there, so it was the obvious target to go for. So far so good. But here's the next problem I had to overcome, and the difficulty wasn't with the plane, it was with me. And not once have I looked around to see where the A5M is, or any other planes for that matter. Very, very quickly I developed tunnel vision on the Ki-43. My speed from the divers allowed me to easily outfly this Hayabusa, but I'm taking too long to kill him, and my situational awareness is gone. The A5M just went past me and head-on, so doubtless he will now be looping onto my tail. Instead of just flying away, using what's remaining of my speed, I decide to turn and dogfight him, and there he is. That's a very bad life choice on my part, as I no longer have a speed advantage. Realising this, I start flying scissors, hoping for an overshoot, and it just ends in a collision. That was so unnecessary, as was this next episode. Here's a Ki-61, just begging for a British lead tattoo across his wings. Now he's turning to run, and I follow. He's jerking his mouse around a bit. I have to pull up sharply to avoid an overshoot. Then he wants to turn fight me, which isn't the 61's strengths. So now I become even more committed to getting the kill. But once more, I'm on his tail. Bad place to be. How long is it now since I looked around? I have zero awareness of my surroundings. All my focus is on that dancing target under my nose. Whenever this happens, you're very likely to die. It's just a matter of how. In this case, a friendly plane did the honours. Ouch. So lesson number two, don't get fixated on one target and practice situational awareness. Paradise Islands was a better map on which to do this, with its large spaces spreading the planes out more than usual. There's three red planes down there chasing one blue. I'm just diving to gain speed, and I'll choose my target when I get closer. Sorry, two on one blue and a bomber off to the side. And the bomber's alone, so he's the one I'll attack. I've switched to universal ammo as I was unhappy with the results I was getting from stealth. With superior energy, I can pull up into a high yo-yo whenever the Stuka turns, and then start another attacking pass with renewed speed. This gives me frequent pauses in which to see what's going on around me. I can see a pea shooter's coming in, and I'm just going to try and climb as much as I can. It's not a great deal, but it's enough to give me a bit of speed when I commit to attacking him. Also lets me look around and see if there's any other enemies incoming before I again commit to the attack. And with that extra speed, I continue to get glancing deflection shots at him, and I have no trouble following his turns. Attacking isolated enemies like this is great, but it's very important not to become isolated yourself. Here I separated myself from friendly fighters, and two Ishaks have lined me up from distance. I didn't see the threat coming until it was too late. See Psycho Bob at the top right. Another guy coming from lower down. I suddenly realize Psycho Bob's heading straight at me, so I have to dodge his head on. And then the next one's coming straight at me. I have to do the same thing. And the Spitfire cannot dogfight one Ishaq, let alone two. It turns faster than you do. And neither can it run away. The moral of this story is don't stray too far from friendly fighter support. So enough of showing my mistakes. It's time to look at how to use this plane well. Yes, you need to engage low-level targets, but that doesn't mean heading for the nearest furball and killing a plane or two before you die. My preference is always to survive as long as possible, to the end of the battle if I can. And I approach the Spitfire the same way. So my initial tactic is in-game is to climb to mid-altitude and then hang back in defense to find an isolated target and swoop on it, and then climb and reset for my next attack. That's very conservative. It's basically boom and zooming. But then it can develop into dogfighting when the situation demands it. Eventually, though, you'll run out of easier isolated targets and you'll have to engage the furball. And here's the way I go about it. I've regained altitude and I'm flying above the action, watching to see how it unfolds. There's no rush, as once I'm committed to battle, it's hard to escape, so I only want to attack when the odds are in my favour. Now I've decided to dive because they're starting to split up down there. And that lag had isolated himself from the pack, so I decided to continue the dive at him. This takes me back toward friendly territory and near cliffs that I can use for cover if needed. So I've overshot him. I'll just extend away and then reassess the situation. He's still isolated, so I'm going to turn back for the attack again. Using an Immelman to regain a bit of altitude and give me some more dive speed. Now suddenly the furball's back here. I'm dodging head-ons. Got to make sure that I myself am not an easy target for anyone. Survival is the first priority. Killing targets the second. Okay, they all seem to be heading in one direction. Nice deflection shot on that Spitfire. And I'm on the tail end of a queue. It's good to be behind an enemy kill train. But I suddenly have the sense here that new enemies are arriving, so I'm going to put safety before greed, and I'm going to take cover in this little cleft in the landscape here. And sure enough, that lag would have taken me out if I hadn't been awake. He tries to follow my turn, which is his undoing. Alright, as I climb back up, just reassessing the situation again. Seeing where everyone is. And there's a steady stream of red planes arriving, but plenty of blues as well. All I need to do is keep my awareness and high and maintain my speed, going for deflection shots rather than settling onto a target 6. Looks like I've done that guy some critical damage. Someone's on me. I'm just pulling up and looping over a bit, hoping they'll overshoot, but it's a Chaika. That's not good news, and there's a bow fighter coming in with him. Fortunately, I couldn't do some damage to the Chaika there, so now I'm in trouble. I can't dogfight a Chaika, and I probably don't have the energy to outrun him, and there's a bow fighter here as well, and suddenly the friendlies seem to be all gone. So I'm just going to try and survive and hope that support arrives. So I'm leading the Chaika into a dive, and then I'm going to quickly loop to see if it shakes him. No such luck. Yep, he's still happily settling on my tail. I'm trying to barrel roll over him. I cannot outmaneuver a Chaika for long. And that's a very bad time to bump the tab key instead of the Q for rudder. So now I'm at ground level and I'm out of options. All I can do is evade and hope for rescue. I had the landing flaps out again to try and force him to overshoot, so I've tucked those away, and I'm just basically flying in the direction of my own base, trying to be a hard target. Okay, so the cavalry's arrived. I'm not dead yet, so it's time to rejoin the battle. I'm back to using stealth again in this battle. I could never make up my mind which ammo worked best between stealth and universal, but in this case, as you'll see, it certainly helped. Because that Shiker had lost awareness of me. And didn't react when I started plinking away at him. I get a bit of tunnel vision here. There's a lot of reds in this area. I probably shouldn't be pressing in to attack. Okay, there's a bow fighter behind me somewhere. There's yaks around. A Fogliori down at the valley floor there, an easy target. And there's Tracer from the bow fighter at me, so I'm in a bit of trouble here. Not to mention I have a black wing, which makes this plane very hard to maneuver. And yep, the bow fighter got me. But that wasn't a bad run. Domination games are of course characterized by low altitude fighting, so the Spitfire is right at home. As usual, I'm starting from mid altitude and beginning with conservative attack runs, as if I'm in an energy fighter. Just commencing a dive, then picking out a target. Either the lag or the P-36. The lag. That's why you need close convergence setting. It's at point-blank range that 303s really do the most damage. Obviously the advantage with stealth is that enemies can't see your shots, but I think the disadvantage is you really can't be sure where your bullets are going. So you waste a lot of ammo, and that's why I sometimes feel like nothing is actually hitting targets. I'm just shooting astray. With the Tracer, it's easy to aim. But of course, you will let your enemies to the fact they're being shot at. So anyway, I'm regaining altitude and circling around, and I can watch the battle develop and make an informed choice about how and where I commit. No one's picked up that biplane on the runway. The coast is clear for me to take him out and then escape. So that's two kills with minimal risk, and the battle is still young. Okay, reset to my patrol altitude again. Generally don't go higher than 2,000 metres. 1,000 is enough to make a diving attack. And going off to the right-hand side is a Hurricane. And a P-36 behind him. I'll attack the back marker first. Hurricane's killed himself, so it's just the P-36. So I have speed for my dive, and I'm going to conserve it by looping up and over in the turn, rather than following him horizontally. And this saves me from any chance of colliding with that enemy, that friendly in the A-5M, who's on the Hawks, 6 o'clock. So he's down and I spot a Heinkel 51 over to the side, who looks like he's sneaking over to cap our airfield. So I'm accelerating into a bit of a shallow dive to get the speed to quickly intercept. There's a blinking red light behind me and F4F is trailing from a distance. Which is fine, I should be able to take the biplane down quickly, after which the F4F will be an easy kill, as that plane is a worse turn fighter than me. And he's not approaching me with an energy advantage, which he should be. so I just got to avoid his head on. And now that F4F will regret attacking a Spitfire without a speed advantage. I've deployed flaps deliberately to slow my plane down, as a Wildcat is even worse at slow speed, and I'm using rudder to turn inside. See how effective that rudder is on shortening the turn. Don't let anyone tell you that rudder has no place in a turn fight, as I've seen someone post on a forum recently. Nice shot in there, and good old American fighters in their glass tails. Down he goes. So I'll just skip a little ahead now, as I fly back to the middle airfield. And here's where this battle is going to be won or lost, and it looks like it's not going well for my team. So, sensing that it's coming to a close, I'm going to step up the aggression. So I'm diving in now without much delay. Again, a close range shot. And by the way, don't even think about speed capping in this plane. You'll definitely break your propeller. You just got to concentrate on killing enemies and hope that other people on your team will cap. KO-45 is a reasonably good turner. Incredibly fragile though. Once again, I'm not going to follow him in his turn. Prefer to use what energy I have to perform an Immelmann. Notice how little actual turn fighting I've actually had to do in this battle. Nearly every engagement I've basically used energy tactics rather than just straight horizontal turning. And that's exactly how it should be. That one's come to a close. And to conclude, here's a summary of the tactics I believe are the most effective way to fly this plane in arcade. While making this video, I scored 34 kills at the cost of 8 deaths over 13 flights, which isn't bad. When I did lose the Spit 1, I flew the Hurricane Mark 2 in exactly the same way, and I killed 14 opponents while dying just once. The Hurricane does everything the Spit Mark 1 does, only better. Regardless, whenever I fly low to Tier 2 British, I'll always take the Spitfire out first, simply because it is such an iconic plane. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching, and I hope to meet you in the skies.